Hello everyone, it's 9 o'clock again on this Good Friday evening, and thank you for joining me as we continue our studies in the Word of God, or from the Word of God. We are doing a series on Philippians right now, and I will read chapter 1 verse 20 for the sake of connection, because we stopped at that point yesterday, and then I will go on to verse 21. That's our starting point for today. I eagerly expect and hope that I will in no way be ashamed, but will have sufficient courage, so that now, as always, Christ will be exalted in my body, whether by life or by death. So we have seen that by living, we can bear happy testimony to Him, and by dying also, we can magnify and glorify God. Bodies pierced by knives and spears, torn by wild beasts, or burnt at the stake. But as I finished yesterday, most of us are not called to be martyrs, but our bodies can magnify God or glorify God by being worn out in God's service. So today we start with chapter 1 and verse 21, and this is perhaps one of the best known verses in God's word. For to me, to live is Christ, and to die is gain. You can speak for hours and hours on this particular verse, but it's so important. For to me, to live is Christ, and to die is gain. For many people, it is to live is earthly gain, and to die would be the end of that gain. For lots of people, all that they gain in this world is limited to this world, and then when they die, it's all lost, it's all gone forever. But for a true believer, to live is to be with Christ, is Christ, and to die is beneficial, or it is a gain. Because Christ was the source and secret of Paul's continual joy, even in imprisonment. Now remember, when he wrote this book, he was chained to a Roman soldier. So for Paul, life found all its meaning in Christ. So if we find joy or satisfaction in the circumstances around us, most of the time we will all be disappointed people. We'll all be dissatisfied and we'll be depressed. But if we find our meaning in life in Christ, then life would be something absolutely marvelous. Because the things of this world, the broken cisterns of this world, like money and fame and satisfaction and earthly satisfaction and pleasure, and all of those are broken cisterns. They can never bring us true joy. But when we are in Christ, even in terrible circumstances, we can find peace and joy in life. So Paul's philosophy in life and the object of his life was to love, to worship, and to serve the Lord Jesus. Paul did not live for money, or for fame, or for pleasure. Paul's ultimate concern and his most prized possession, both now and forever, was the Lord Jesus and his relationship to him. So the primary thing about life is, this life is transient, it is temporary, and it's not really going to work for us if we find joy from the things of this world. It's not going to work. So we need to find joy in our relationship with God. A writer by the name of Jowett said to Apostle Paul, death was not a darksome passageway where all our treasures rot away in a swift corruption. It is a place of gracious transition, a covered way that leads into light. Interestingly, when Paul speaks about dying in this particular way, in this particular verse, to say to die is gain, the word die here in the original Greek actually means depart, not ceasing to exist. Because in the Bible, death is not the end of things. It is not the cessation of life or cessation of activity. Life is continuous. Whether we continue in heaven or in hell, life continues on and on and on forever. So when we die, we only move from this plane of existence into a different one. So that we need to remember and understand. So death is not the end of things. Death is only a change of our existence or place of existence. So the word that is used, the Greek word that is used for die, basically means depart or departing. And it's used of, say, in four different situations. Firstly, it is used of soldiers when they move camp, when they take the tent and they move on to another place. It is used of sailors when they depart a harbor, when they leave a harbor to loosen the ship and to set sail. It is even used of jailers who set the prisoners free, enable them to depart from prison. It is also used of farmers when they unyoke the oxen. So death is not the end of things. It is not ceasing to exist. Death is primarily departing from this planet to another place. So for Paul, when he says, for me to live is Christ and to die is gain, for Paul, death meant freedom from his problems, from the terrible persecutions that he was facing, from imprisonment, from suffering, hunger, thirst, and the burdens of ministry. These are mentioned in 2 Corinthians 11, 22 to chapter 12, verse 10. Let me repeat the problems that Paul had. For Paul, death meant freedom from his problems, persecutions, imprisonment, suffering, hunger, thirst, and burdens of the ministry. Still, he doesn't want to be released from these for the sake of Christ and for his people. So for Paul, whether he lives or dies, both are beneficial. Because for him to live is to serve God, and to die is really beneficial to be in the Lord's presence. And he explains that in the next couple of verses. Philippians 1:22. If I am to go on living in the body, this will mean fruitful labor for me. Yet, what shall I choose? I do not know. So if it were God's will for him, for Paul, to live a bit longer, it would mean the continuous spread of the gospel and the building up of the body of Christ. So Paul was happy with either situation. For him, both are a win-win situation. So for a believer, living is a win situation. Dying is also a win situation. For a mature Christian, living in God's will, there is no defeat. It is always victory in Christ Jesus. 1 Corinthians 15:57. But thanks be to God, he gives us the victory through our Lord Jesus Christ. 2 Corinthians 2:14. But thanks be to God, who always leads us in triumphal procession in Christ, and through us spreads everywhere the fragrance of the knowledge of him. So to live is Christ, and to die is gain. Verse 23. I am torn between the two, that is, to live for Christ or to die. I desire to depart and be with Christ, which is better by far. So torn between the two is primarily, he's being hard pressed between the two. It's a difficult decision with two possibilities. Because a Christian goes to be with Christ at the time of his death, and he is in conscious enjoyment of the presence of God. So if we live, here we are living with Christ, and the presence of God, the presence of Christ is real in our lives. Even when we die, we continue to be in the Lord's presence, and we continue to enjoy the presence of God. At his right hand are pleasures forevermore, the word of God tells us. Philippians 1:24. But it is more necessary for you that I remain in the body. Now, Paul says that at that point of time, it was very important for him to continue to live, primarily because the church needed him at that stage. So he prefers, or he puts the needs of those he ministers to ahead of his personal preference. Verse 25. Convinced of this, I know that I will remain and I will continue with all of you for your progress and joy in the faith. Paul was confident that he was still needed on this earth to instruct, comfort, and encourage the saints. Paul was not just living on this planet to consume resources. He was being used by God. So this is important. If we are going to continue to live on this planet, we need to ensure that we don't just consume resources. We are not just adding to the numbers. We must make a difference in the lives of others. We must make a difference in the kingdom of God. Verse 26. So that through my being with you, again, your joy in Christ Jesus will overflow on account of me. So Paul's conduct of his ministry among the Philippians will be a reason for rejoicing in what Christ is doing among them. So Paul's ministry made an impact in the Christian church, especially in the Philippian church. It made an impact and it was leading them into greater joy in Christ. Then verse 27 is a slightly longer verse. Whatever happens, conduct yourselves in a manner worthy of the gospel of Christ. Then whether I come and see you or only hear about you in my absence, I will know that you stand firm in one spirit, contending as one man for the faith of the gospel. So he says, conduct yourselves in a manner worthy of the gospel of Christ. Now the term conduct yourselves in the original Greek primarily means to behave like a citizen. Remember, we are citizens of the kingdom of God. So we need to behave like citizens of the kingdom of God. And it also means, that Greek phrase also means, to recognize the laws of the city, which means we have to live according to kingdom principles, not according to the principles of this world. So citizens of heaven, because we are citizens of heaven, we should behave accordingly, appropriate with the standards and the goals given with the gospel. This is from a hymn, and I quote, "You are writing a gospel, a chapter each day, by the deeds that you do and the words that you say. Men read what you write, whether faithful or true. Just what is the gospel according to you?" Let me read that again, because it's significant. You're writing a gospel, a chapter each day, by the deeds that you do and the words that you say. Men read what you write, whether faithful or true. Just what is the gospel according to you? So we've got to realize that as citizens of a heavenly kingdom, we need to live according to the principles and the laws of the heavenly kingdom. Christian life is not a playground. It is a spiritual battleground. And one of the greatest weapons against the devil is a godly life. So he says that we should contend for the gospel. Now, what does the term contend mean? There, in the original Greek, it means together to be an athlete. So it basically means team spirit, esprit de corps, the body concept, that we are to work together. All believers are to work together and be united in the spirit. Philippians 1:28. Without being frightened in any way by those who oppose you, this is a sign to them that they will be destroyed, but that you will be saved, and that by God. Now, persistent opposition to the church and to the gospel is a sure sign of eventual destruction, since it involves rejection of the only way of salvation. When Christians are persecuted for their faith, it is a sign of the genuineness of their faith. It also shows who the true Christians are. Because those who are only professing Christians will run away in times of persecution. The ones who are persecuted and who stand faithful in persecution are the true believers. So persecution divides the men from the boys. It divides the true believers from the false believers. Verse 29 of Philippians 1. For it has been granted to you on behalf of Christ not only to believe on him, but also to suffer for him. We must realize that it is a privilege to suffer for Christ. Only today I saw a series of messages on somebody's Facebook wall when somebody says, since Christ has suffered and died for us, why should we Christians suffer? But if you read the scriptures very carefully, we must understand that we live in a world that is opposed to God, that is in conflict, at warfare with God. And it is a world in which we are called to suffer. And the Lord very clearly shows us that even the Lord Jesus had to be made perfect, not that he wasn't perfect, had to fulfill his perfection through suffering. In John 16 and verse 33, I have told you these things so that in me you may have peace. And then the Lord Jesus tells his disciples, in this world you will have trouble, but take heart, I have overcome the world. 2 Timothy 3:12, in fact, everyone who wants to live a godly life in Christ Jesus will be persecuted. Let me read that again. In fact, everyone who wants to live a godly life in Christ Jesus will be persecuted. If you take all the teachings given to the body of Christ in the epistles, which is primarily for the church age, you notice that God doesn't promise us material prosperity, which is quite in conflict with many of the prosperity preachers are saying today. God only promises to meet our needs. And everywhere in the New Testament, the Lord is talking about material wealth. He's basically telling us first to put the kingdom of God and his righteousness first, and all these things will be given to us as well. And everywhere he talks about money, he talks about not to have love of money. But basically, he wants us to treat money like a servant rather than as a master. And everywhere he talks about material wealth, he only promises to be, he commands us to be content with what we have. And he promises that he will never leave us, nor will he forsake us. Money is necessary. It is a wonderful tool that God has given to humanity, but it should not become our master. So in this world, we will suffer. We are called to be persecuted. Sometimes the persecution is physical, but many a time it is psychological, it is economical, it is social. But we are called to suffer. So remember, it is a privilege to suffer for the kingdom. It is a privilege to suffer for Christ. Christian suffering, as well as faith, is a blessing. The cross today is Good Friday. The cross dignifies and it ennobles us. So remember, in this world, we will suffer. Everyone who wants to live a godly life in Christ Jesus will be persecuted. And Paul also exhorts Timothy that as a good soldier of Jesus Christ, to stand firm and to accept suffering. Verse 30, the last verse of Philippians 1. Since you are going through the same struggle you saw I had and now hear that I still have. So the word struggle here in the original Greek means to struggle with dangers and obstacles. In fact, the Greek word is agon. From that you get the English word agony. And it's the same word agon that is used about the agony of our Lord Jesus Christ in the Garden of Gethsemane. Satan wants us to think that we are alone in the battle and that our difficulties are quite unique. But Paul reminds Philippians that he was going through the same struggles in Rome. So remember, we are not unique. There are others suffering like us. So it's easy to get into a kind of a situation of self-pity and think that only we are going through it. No, others are going through it as well. So I leave 5 questions with us before we move on to chapter 2. First one, and always remember, when I say you, I'm including myself as well in these challenges. First one, is your Christian life in active progression or in passive regression? I'd like to illustrate this in the form of a bicycle, or you're riding a bicycle on a steep hill, maybe 35 to 40 degrees. It's pretty steep. And this bicycle does not have brakes. So you either keep pedaling, struggling with it, and pedaling little by little and progress slowly. But if you stop pedaling, you come down faster than the speed at which you were going up. So that's why, is your Christian life in active progression or in passive regression? Second question. Do you complain about your circumstances or see them as opportunities for the proclamation of the gospel and for your spiritual growth? Thirdly, why are you serving the Lord? What are your motives? Who or what is the primary source of joy in your life? Finally, are you conducting yourself worthy, or are you conducting yourself in a manner worthy of the gospel of Christ? Now we move on to the next part, which is an exhortation to unity. This is chapter 2, verses 1 to 16. Obviously, we do a study for half an hour. I've got 9 minutes more, so I won't be able to finish this, but let's start off on this. And this is based on Christ's example of humility and sacrifice. Exhortation to unity. Chapter 2, verse 1. Paul talks about 5 positive things here. If you have any encouragement, 1, from being united with Christ. If any comfort from his love, 2. If any fellowship with his spirit, 3. If any tenderness, 4. And compassion, 5. So chapter 2 deals with the cause and the cure of contentions or problems or lack of unity among the people of God. Although the Philippian church was exemplary in many ways, in many respects, there was an undercurrent of strife. As I always say, no church is perfect, because church is made up of sinners saved by grace. None of us are perfect. If you have found a church that is 100% perfect, the chances are that you are dead and you are in heaven. So no church is perfect, and nor was the Philippian church. Firstly, false teachers were coming from the outside. We will see this in the next chapter, the first 3 verses. And there were 2 women called Euodia and Syntyche. They were having a difference of opinion. Chapter 4 and verse 2. Ironically, Euodia means fragrance. Syntyche means fortunate. So fortunate and fragrance were having a fight with each other. So this goes on to show that we don't live according to the names that we have. So when you are born, for every parent, their child is the best in the world, and they give us fancy names and fancy terms, and most of the time we don't live according to our names. So fragrance and fortunate are having a difference of opinion. Now the disagreements in the church reveal that there is a spiritual problem in the fellowship. And it is not going to be solved by rules or the constitution of the church or by threats. It's going to be solved when the hearts of the members are right with Christ and with each other. So Paul wanted the Philippians to see that the basic cause of disunity or contention or fights within the church was selfishness. And this selfishness is caused by pride. So he talks about 5 things in this verse. First one is encouragement. In the King James, Old King James version, the word is consolation. So the Greek word there, paraklesis, primarily means call to one's side. That means when you are comforting somebody, when you are consoling somebody, or when you are protecting somebody, you grasp that person and you kind of keep that person's head against your chest. So that's the meaning that comes out here. Call to one side means comfort or protection. So first thing that we need to show against, or show to other church members, is comfort and protection. That is encouragement. Second word In the NIV, is translated also in the King James Version, is translated as comfort, but it is a stronger word than encouragement, because it involves tenderness attached to it. So not only are you comforting or encouraging somebody, but you are doing that with tenderness, with love and affection. The third one is fellowship. The Greek word is koinonia. It appears about 20 times in the New Testament, and this means sharing something in common. That when we belong to the body of Christ, we need to share our time, talent, and treasure with the others. Then he also goes on to talk about tenderness and compassion. So these are primarily the heart for us. See, for us, we are influenced by Western thought, and for us, the heart is the seat of emotions. So that's why when you love somebody or when you want to show love, you draw a heart. But for the Greeks, their seat of emotion were their intestines, basically. And that's the word that is used here. And which means that when we are united with Christ, encouragement, comfort, fellowship, tenderness, and compassion will become present realities. So if you want unity in the church, we would urge each pastor or priest or leaders to encourage the believers to grow in the faith and become mature. And that's the way you are going to have unity in the body. Chapter 2 and verse 2. Then make my joy complete by being like-minded, having the same love, being one in spirit and purpose. Like-minded, that is unity based on common devotion to Christ and common possession of the Holy Spirit. Now, we must distinguish between unity and uniformity. And that would be my final thought for the evening. Now, unity is a matter of the heart. Uniformity is as a result of outside pressure. It is possible to have unity without having uniformity. We don't all have to be the same. We don't have to all conform to the same practical aspects. But on the fundamentals of the Christian faith, we need to be united. And there can be a difference of opinion on minor issues. And that is normal. Even in the New Testament church, the early church, you see this. One of my favorite quotes in Christianity comes from J.N. Darby. And he said, in essentials, unity. In non-essentials, liberty. But in all things, charity. In essentials, unity. In non-essentials, liberty. In all things, charity. For example, when it comes to the fundamentals of the faith, some examples like the virgin birth of Christ, the sinlessness of Christ, and his substitutionary death for us on the cross at Calvary, him being the only way to God, his bodily resurrection, and his soon coming. On these, we cannot compromise. Pardon me. In essentials, unity. But in non-essentials, liberty. Our physical posture when it comes to worship in the New Testament church is not very clearly laid out in the New Testament. So, in terms of use of instruments, musical instruments in worship, it's not clearly laid out in the New Testament. So there we can have liberty. But in all things, whether in unity or in liberty, in essentials or non-essentials, we must have charity. It must all be driven by love. And to close this verse, he says, being in one spirit and purpose, which means harmonious, united in spirit and thinking as one thing. The body of Christ needs unity, and it needs to continue to be united until the Lord returns. So thank you for joining me today. Every night at 9 o'clock Sri Lanka time, we have this study on Facebook Live. And I'm also going to upload it to my Facebook page, and you can watch it again. Or if you come in late, you can watch it. And join me tomorrow night at 9 o'clock. And also on Sunday morning at 9:30, we have an extra session on the resurrection of our Lord. So Sunday morning it will be 9:30 in the morning and 9 in the night. 9 in the night will continue every day. And we are going to now close in prayer. Our loving Father, thank you and praise you for your love, mercy and compassion towards us, Father. Thank you, Lord, for the unity of the Spirit that we see to some extent in the body of Christ. Lord, help us to grow and become mature in the faith. Lord, I thank you for these studies, which is proclaimed in human frailty, but we know that it is empowered by the Spirit of God. Pray that you will speak to each one of us in a special way, Father, and draw us close to you, even during this time of pain, illness, and an unseen enemy. Lord, we pray that you will continue to protect us and our families. We commit our land into your hands, Father. We pray that this virus will be completely eradicated, not only from Sri Lanka, but from the rest of the world, Father. We commit those who are vulnerable. We pray that you will provide. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So good night. God bless you and keep safe.